Hello, fight fans. It is Monday, March 20th, 2017. My name is Luke Thomas, and this is the Monday Morning Analyst here on MMAfighting.com. Three parts to the podcast. As always, we go over sort of the fights over the weekend, then we get into something a little bit specific in detail in the second segment, and then take a look at what's coming up ahead in the third. Now, this is a bit of an interesting weekend, if it's not, as we go ahead and get right into the matter of things. There was really only one, and even then it wasn't a major event, relatively major event, in UFC London, UFC Fight Night 107, UFC Fight Night Manuwa versus Anderson. We'll spend the bulk of our time talking about that. A couple of fights I want to highlight from World Series of Fighting 35. But I normally only talk about MMA on this show, and I'm not really going to change that today, but it was a pretty tremendous weekend in combat sports. You had those two events I just mentioned, the UFC and World Series of Fighting ones. There was countless regional shows, of course. That's always the case during the weekends. But there were some bigger events, too. There was the IBJJF Pan-Am Championships, the NCAA Wrestling Championships, and there was Triple G versus Jacobs. So all three of those I watched. I mean, I didn't watch every single match on the Pan-Ams. You can't, but you get the idea. I watched a lot of it. I don't have a lot of commentary to offer because I don't think a lot of you really care about a lot of those things. Let me just say a couple of things. I think the flow grappling broadcast of the IBJJF Pan-Ams, or the Pans, as it said, called in short, is really, really good. I like that you can just jump mat to mat. Plus, they have what's called the flow zone, where the two commentators will just sort of talk over it. And it's great. You can watch from white belt to blue to purple to brown. Frankly, my favorites are the brown and the purple. The black belt is just, it's, by the time you get to black belts, it's, especially with the lighter weight classes, like, I have a tremendous amount of respect for Bruno Malfacini, but it's just leg entanglements the whole time. It's double guard pulls, leg entanglements. It's not a ton of fun. At purple and brown, you get a lot more, I think, action for the most part. Big winners, of course, Leandro Lowe, I think taking double gold, you know, moving up to higher weight classes, which has been something of a source of suspicion, but nevertheless, the overall presentation by Flo was great. The overall tournament was great. This is not Flo's fault, but IBJJF's fault. They're really good about just showing you lots of action, action, action. By the time they get to the championships, they drag, and you get a lot of closeouts. So the tournament itself is great. The end of the tournament is not. You know, a lot of your standouts, again, Leandro Lowe. I'm trying to think of who else. Tanner Rice gave us some trouble early, but in the end kind of faded there. During the rest of the event, who also really stuck out to me? My instructor at the school I attend, Beta Academy, got bronze in Masters 2, so shouts to him. And there was, a great drop Sayanagi, which I posted. I'll link in the description box below in the open weight female. It looked like Dern versus Gabby Garcia. It was not, of course, but the same kind of size discrepancy. And the smaller competitor hits an amazing drop Sayanagi, really incredible. So there was always kinds of different moments throughout the tournament, but the last part is when they had the lower thirds, you know, X versus Y, they put the full name. So if you get these guys from South America, either, you know, Spanish or Portuguese speaking, they have these long names, Jesus, Franco, Basto, Ramirez, Castro, and it just goes on and on and on and on and on. And so you can't actually see who it is. They might go by a name you don't even ordinarily recognize. You have to do a lot of facial recognition. I had to sort of spot the Meow brothers, Joao Meow, by doing that, you know. So it got a little annoying with that. I don't like that so much. But generally speaking, the seven mats with the flow zone is a really, really nice way to broadcast that. And by the way, ESPN doesn't do that for the NCAA Wrestling Championships. Obviously, a couple standouts there as well. Bo Nickel winning the way he did, jumping up a weight class was pretty incredible. Penn State is just unstoppable at this point, right? And how about Kyle Snyder, 21 years old, multiple-time NCAA champion, world champion, Olympic champion, hoisting a guy in the air from Wisconsin, whose name escapes me now, who was almost 50 pounds heavier than him after having a busted rib that happened two rounds prior to that. I mean, he might go down as one of the greatest heavyweights in American wrestling history at this point. Pretty incredible what he's able to do, so keep an eye out for him. I didn't really watch those events up until the sort of semis, and I watched some of the wrestlebacks. Jaden Cox had a nice tournament as well. Missouri had an okay tournament in general, in terms of just, you know, how many times did you see a tiger striped singlet in a bout of or match of consequence? Pretty often. And then, of course, Kyle Snyder wrestles for Ohio State. They didn't have quite the tournament that they did last year, so keep that in mind. But, you know, Zane Rutherford had a nice tournament. Isaiah Martinez getting pinned. That was pretty incredible by Vincenzo Joseph, I believe is his last name. So Penn State really just really ran over people. Then in Triple G versus Daniel Jacobs, I thought Jacobs won. Now, not by like any kind of crazy margin. I wouldn't argue too much if you thought the other way. It's not one of those kinds of things. But I didn't think it was a particularly strong performance by Triple G. He had the one knockdown, and even that one looked like it just sort of may have been, I mean, it landed hard, but it also may have been partially a trip as well, or at least some kind of obstruction with his feet. So, I don't know. It just, even if you think he won, and that's fine, I wouldn't argue too much with it. I don't think, like, Jacobs won, oh my God, but, you know, it was, it just couldn't really get a whole lot of offense going. Doing a lot of cornering, but never really able to get several punch combinations working while Jacobs was able to. The speed of Jacobs, I think some of the ring generalship of Jacobs gave Triple G some problems. So what does that mean going forward, even though Jacobs won? I don't know. I'm sorry, even though Triple G won. You know, are they ever going to make a Canelo fight? Your guess is as good as mine, but there you go. All right. I usually don't go into stuff like that, but it was such a big weekend I had to. Now, on to the business. UFC Fight Night, Manuwa versus Anderson. This took place at the O2 Arena in London, England, with an attendance 15,761 for a total gate of just over 2 million, 2,015,777. In the main event, Jimi Manuwa at light heavyweight defeating Cody Anderson at 305 of the very first round via KO. We'll go over this more in the second segment, not in super great detail, frankly very little detail, but just enough so you can see just how incredible the left hook is of Jimi Manuwa. But you know, what did you really notice from him in this one? He didn't flinch a lot. Like, Cody Anderson does a lot of moving side to side, in and out, level changes, fakes with his hands, feints. Manuwa bit on it very little. He had real clear sense of what the noise was and what the signal was in Anderson's game. It was able to tell the difference between them. I was able to catch him all throughout the course of that very short bout. As a result, there were a couple times where you saw Manuwa biting on things, but Manuwa really maintaining distance in a proper way, so they never had to do a whole lot of motioning himself. Never felt like whatever Cody Anderson was doing, he had to react to it. Just really kind of incredible to see a guy who has that kind of poise under fire, economical, efficient motions, right? Doesn't use a lot of energy. Improved takedown defense. Now some of those takedowns were just, you know, not even real knee taps. Like if they were there, he'd go for them, but if they're not, he'd be Anderson would be happy to abandon him. There was the one attempt, which Manuwa got away from, that was pretty good, not great, because a couple times he got caught with his hands out in front of him a little bit, which commentator Dan Hardy noticed. But still, that's for Jimi Manuwa, that's very much improved takedown defense. Now, we still don't know how he would look if he had gotten flattened on his back and then had to get back up again. I mean, we know we've seen him do that before, but I just mean in this context, with somebody who can stay on him round after round. But I guess it didn't matter because he never got taken to the ground to begin with. So, you know, Manuwa's only two losses are to Alexander Gustafsson and Anthony Johnson. And I think that tells a lot. I think people were saying, well, you know, his wins weren't so inspiring. And prior to the OSP fight, maybe they weren't. But since then, man, he is looking like he has really turned a corner in his career. He was giving total praise to his team in Sweden. And Alexander Gustafsson, you saw in his corner, the All-Stars, right? This is something that appears to be working out really well for him, and I'm glad to see it because he obviously is a guy with a tremendous amount of ability. Didn't like so much that he was like, John Jones is on steroids, but okay, whatever. We'll all live with that, no problem. It just looked to me like I appreciate what Cody Anderson does and the way in which he moves and how much that can bother certain guys. It had no effect whatsoever on Jimi Manuwa. He no-sold it the whole time. It didn't really affect him at all, and in the end, the way in which, it's funny, a left hook is a weapon, but Jimi Manuwa's left hook is so good, I almost feel like saying he has weaponized it, like he has taken what is ordinarily a weapon and turned it into something at a significantly higher level. Amazing job by Jimi Manuwa, which we'll take a look more at in that second segment. Gunnar Nelson defeating Alan Jouban via guillotine choke, 46 seconds of the second round. He was getting chewed up in that first round, but you guys, if you watched the live chat last week, you know, here's what I thought about Alan Jouban. When he's busy, either coming forward or backing up, and you most recently saw that in the Mike Perry fight, backing up, if he's active, right, on his feet, using great footwork, using great cage generalship, being varied in his attacks, and just sort of staying frequent about it, he can disrupt the rhythm of guys and their ability to get off in ways where he can just sort of take a round over. And then he can find openings and he can really do damage to you. He's a talented guy. He's a very, very talented guy. The problem is there are times in fights where he can get caught, not exactly posing off, but through a combination of timing and what I think is a liability in Jouban, which is to say he doesn't have great anticipatory skills, right? Look at Jimi Manuwa. Jimi Manuwa can look down and through all the bluster of your movement, figure out when exactly that goes away and you're actually trying something. He can see it. Jouban's not quite like that, unfortunately. A good striker, a very talented guy. I'm not bagging on him at all. And in that first round, he had a game plan that was working, and that needs to be acknowledged, right? He was tearing apart that lead leg of Gunnar Nelson, but obviously it didn't last long. He got, you know, the tides turned in the middle of that first round, or the end of that first round anyway, and then, of course, you know what happened in the second. But here's my point about the second round. If you don't have really good anticipatory skills, if you don't have really good ability to see what's coming and then adjust quickly, make a quick movement, a quick parry, a down parry, side parry, and a guy has good, accurate, long-range, powerful striking, you know, they can fire a missile from long range quickly and efficiently, it's kryptonite for you, and that's exactly what Gunnar Nelson does. If you're not that great at anticipating attack and making a quick reaction off of it, and a guy who you're fighting is good at throwing quick reactions from long distances sometimes. This one wasn't super long distance, but certainly far apart, not far apart, you know, reasonably spaced, and can do it accurately and very, very quickly, that's a problem for you. And so that right hand crushed him, dropped him, and from there it was basically academic. You know, he goes for the guillotine choke. It was going to be almost like a ninja choke, not quite all the way, but certainly no arm in, just the neck. He sits, it's not a Marcelo team when you do this, which I kind of got explained poorly the first time, but he only sits knee in, leg on top. He doesn't try to sit into a guard. He sits to the almost, he was almost in side control, but then he slid inside, and then there's really only one way to get out of it. You can try and flip the person over when you do that. Nelson, if you notice, uses one hand. He keeps the choking hand here like this, right? He holds it. He uses the other hand to balance, then went back to the grip and then goes hip in, and when he does that, it's the show is over at that point. So Jouban tapped pretty quickly. So to me, it was like, did Jouban make full use of his ability, especially, let's say, through the first half of that first round? I think he did. I think he game planned correctly, both around Gunnar Nelson and around himself, and executed that correctly as well. It's just that that wasn't enough, you know? This is one of those times where it's like, could things have gone different? Things can always go different, but this is just a difference in the level of fighter, fortunately. And, you know, I think Gunnar Nelson would win that bout 9 times out of 10. Just the way it goes. Now, that being said, some of my colleagues were noting that Gunnar Nelson has improved as a striker, and he has, but it's not a substantial one, and it's fairly marginal in some ways. Like, did you learn anything new about Gunnar Nelson watching that? I don't think you did. Like, we knew what he was capable of doing before that fight, and he did it. He didn't exactly show us a whole lot new. Now, he doesn't need to show you anything new to get the job done, case in point, but you just sort of feel like if a guy borrowed another Rick Story style of game plan and pushed it against him, would it work? I have a feeling that it would. I don't know that I'm seeing a tremendous growth over time. You know, Jouban lost this fight, but I've seen a lot of growth from Jouban. I just haven't seen a whole lot from Gunnar Nelson. So he has obviously an unbelievable ground game, and his striking game is not to be trifled with, but is he making huge strides in that division? Maybe he is. I don't know that this fight was great evidence of that. Marlon Vera defeating Brad Pickett, TKO head kick punches, 350 of the third round. Man, this is just, I mentioned this on my post-fight show. Oh, man. MMA gods are cruel. This is a game, as I said before, that feeds its elderly to its young. There are no fairy tales in this one. If you are able to get out, you are able to get out on your hands and knees at best. I was there when Lyoto Machida retired Randy Couture and knocked his teeth out and sent him crashing to the canvas. Then that's Randy Couture, you know, like there's almost no way to do this well. And to me, if you're losing to Marlon Vera, really a featherweight, but not, you know, this is not a guy who had a particularly strong reputation beforehand. You know, it certainly is time to quit. I mean, we knew he was planning to retire beforehand, of course, and I'm glad the UFC let him go out with his newspaper, but, you know, he just seemed to be like, you could see Brad Pitt, he likes to load up and then drive into punches. He was doing that. It was single-shotting, and Vera has a nice reach and was able to use it for the most part. He was using that step through knee that was causing him problems as well as Pickett was hunching down. And he was losing the first two rounds. The judges all had it, all three judges, each of those two rounds for Pickett. All he had to do was hang on basically another minute. But the problem is he was getting chewed up a little bit on the feet in that third round. Vera was more active. He was able to be first and counter-strike, and I was like, oof, that's a little bit of a problem for Pickett. Even if he was backing up a little bit, he sort of found the opening with the head kick there and let him have it. Stoppage was clean. I wish I could say that it wasn't, but it was. I went back and looked. Everyone's like, he wasn't knocked unconscious. You don't have to knock someone into being unconscious. You have to knock them to a point, whether they choose to do this or whether they physically can't, because maybe you did knock them into unconsciousness. That's not the requirement. All that has to happen is they have to not intelligently defend themselves. And you saw that. There were subsequent shots that were being fired that went in totally unobstructed. And yes, shots sneak through sometimes, but it's quite different to just be there and just take these huge shots, which is what he was doing. So the stoppage was clean, you know. Unfortunately, I hate to say that. But, you know, look, I said this as well after the fights. Does this really change your opinion about Brett Pickett, about what he's done, about some of the wins that he's had, you know? Yves Jabouin, Mike Easton, Demetrius Johnson. I know it was a long time ago, but he was one of those early UK guys who could wrestle a little bit, and that was at bantamweight as well. But still, it's a quality win, man. Like, you're beating DJ at any weight, it's almost a quality win. So, you know, Brad Pickett's contribution to UK MMA and MMA generally, of course, one of the early guys in the smaller weight classes who was able to show well-rounded ability. Certainly, he was viable to the UFC as he was doing these shows overseas, right, in these UK markets. And just one of the early characters as well, one of the really early characters. Just a guy who I think fought the best of his generation and, you know, lost, you know, a lot, but won a lot too. But nevertheless, became a memorable figure for the way in which he competed and for the regularity of how he competed and who he fought against and what he was able to do when he won. So thanks to Brad Pickett for everything he did. Arnold Allen defeating Makwan Amirkhani, split decision 28-29, 30-27. Not sure about the 30-27, but I think the right guy won here. It just looked to me like Amir Khani is much stronger physically and a better wrestler generally, but there is a completeness to his game that is lacking that Arnold Allen has. Arnold Allen just has more two-way traffic going. There is a difference in the wrestling ability, but it's not so substantial. And the defensive hustle and the defensive work generally that Allen is able to cobble together, it just means that in certain positions, he's able to take away any advantage that Makwan Amirkhani has and then begin to attack off of him. Remember, survival, defend, attack. So when he gets taken down and passed to the side, he recaptures half, then full, and then he starts attacking with his guard, or then he begins to initiate a scramble, something like that, right? Whereas Amirkhani likes these big movements, and they're athletic, and he's standing up with a guy on his back and that kind of thing. And those work, too, for a time, but it just tells me that one guy's game in terms of defensive fundamentals is a little bit more complete. Gas tanks, I think, were slightly on Allen's side, although I think he was fading in that third round as well. And stung him with that nice, crisp left, so Amirkhani has a chin on him, too. It's just that their games were pretty closely matched. This was a well-contested fight, really enjoyable to elite guys. I don't think it hurts their stock all that much. Allen probably benefits some from it. And I don't think Makwan takes some huge hit. But if I'm Amirkhani, the lesson I would take is that going forward and attacking, he's a handful. But there are going to be times in fights where you're not. And in scrambles, he needs to find he needs to identify the portions of his defense that are missing and begin to add to that, or at least change the way in which he thinks about defense. You should be thinking about defense as once something is happening to you, where you are now having to defend, you have to take immediate action, even if it means incremental steps. And I don't think he really thinks about defense that way. You got to get going. If you can land a big push and a shove and you can stand, fine, that's great. But that should be your ace in the hole. You can see Allen doesn't think that way. Allen thinks, what's the nearest defensive position That's better than the one I can get to. Let's get to that. Okay, now that I'm here, what's the next nearest defensive position I can get to that's closest to this one? And he gets it, and he gets it, and he gets it. And so he climbs that ladder to a better defensive position. And then once he's in, it's good enough, then he begins to attack from it or initiate a scramble, whatever the case may be. So it looked to me like Arl Allen's game just more complete. Now, before we get to this prelim card, I want to make one statement about officiating on this event. The stand-ups were really, really quick. There was a lot of stalling, which I'll get to in just a second, but there were a lot of times in several of these bouts where I just felt like they were way, way too early with the stand-ups. So I don't know what to do about that. They're trying to give as many referees as they can experience. Leon Roberts was on the card. I think he's a very good referee. There were some other ones that are not that great, but they were having some good stoppages. Like I said, I thought the Pickett stoppage was just fine. Obviously, the stoppage at the main event was totally appropriate as well, but some of the stand-ups, really, really quick, and there are going to be times for separating guys. There were a lot of cases where I didn't think that was the case. I will identify a couple, though. Joe Duffy defeating Reza Madadi, unanimous decision, 30-27 across the board. What can we say about this one? Look, this is a great performance from Joe Duffy. No one can say otherwise. The dynamism of his boxing was totally on display, both with head movement. I love it when guys in MMA have long, lanky, stinging, quick, accurate jabs. And he does, man. He has vicious ground and pound on top. You saw when he got lifted, he had the presence of mind to do that Faraz Zahabi, what's called a web guard. He modified it in real time and used it to turn over. But you can use it to hit arm bars and things like that as well. So he's a well-schooled athlete. Great presence of mind, stays calm, he's got a lot of weapons, working on his takedown defense and some other things. I think that could still use some work, to be honest. He doesn't quite get his hips turned over in enough of a way, I think he likes his guard game, so he's willing to accept playing guard a little bit. But, you know, those things he can work on, he does have time, he's with the right team to do it, just sort of a bit of a change in mentality. But what I really liked from him was just the diversity of his offense, how clearly superior he was to Madadi. The only thing I would say, though, is I think there's another gear or two he can hit that he didn't in this fight. And I really hope the UFC re-signs him because, look, if he goes to Bellator, because that's the better option, and that's the better option, and I guess we all just have to live with it. But my only point is, as good as this was for Duffy, I don't believe this was this is all he has to offer. I think he's got more, and I'd like to see it. Francis Barbosa defeating Darren Stewart, 29-28 across the board. Terrible fight. Timothy Johnson defeating Daniel Omelianchuk, split decision, 28-29, 30-27, and 29-28. That's a weird scorecard. Terrible fight. Leon Edwards defeating Vicente Luque, unanimous decision, 29-28. This was a really interesting fight. Not Luque's best performance. I think he showed some of the things he's good at and some other ones not. This is an interesting one, though. This is one of those times where I did think referee separation was good. It was very interesting to me. Even if Leon Edwards got a great shot on Luque, he had not strong finishing. And a lot of times these guys would find each other against the fence, and they couldn't really do much to each other. They didn't have strong fence finishing skills, and it made the action drag a little bit. So that part was not that great from either guy. I will say that the ability to get a switch off of single leg attacks by Edwards was really strong. He did it several times throughout the course of the bout. They were standing opposite stance, and so you saw Edwards and Luque looking for lead foot dominance. And Luque, I think, had problems getting close enough to establish that outside foot and then find a ability to land. Edwards did it much more efficiently. Edwards using his length and his reach very effectively. And when they were exchanging, first of all, that body kick from Edwards was tremendous. But more than that, if they were throwing combinations, Luque is good about getting out of the way of the first one. But after that, it becomes a little bit more robotic, and that's when Edwards would take over. Edwards can get out of the way of the first, second, and third, and then fire a shot. He just got a little bit more depth to his striking game that Luque is sort of building upon. Luque has good ground game. There was one thing he was doing I didn't like. If he was trying to pass or at least move around to the side, he would post his hand next to the hip to prevent Luque's hips from going that direction, but they don't stop someone's hips from turning over. And so he was essentially, okay, you can't move that direction. If I post my hand next to your hip, you can't go that direction. But if I'm posting on the ground, you can still spin over because I don't have control of your hips. So that was sort of a weird decision he was making. Plus, you wind up doing that Three Stooges bit where, you know, each person is sort of following the next in the turn. Anyway, so not the best performance from Vicente Luque. both guys having trouble against the fence, but I thought, I won't say flashes of brilliance, strong moments from Leon Edwards, and a quality win as well. Mark Diakisi, I think that's how you pronounce his name, Mark Diakisi, defeats Teemu Pakkala 30 seconds into the first round. I mean, this was just a vicious mugging, to be honest. Man, there are so many times people say, you got to watch out for this guy. It's, particularly if they're not from America. You hear this a lot, you know? I mean, they say about American prospects, too, but I think people are dying to find, like, the next big guy from overseas as those scenes get better and better and better. And I can understand that impulse completely, but a lot of times there's a lot of false hype around a guy. I don't think this is one of those cases. Now, look, we're going to see how he can develop his game. Now that he's at ATT, there's a strong reason to believe he's going to be able to do something special in that lightweight division, but his striking is so effortless, so instinctive, so reactive, so powerful. He's so athletic, so great body awareness, total poise under fire, absolute fundamental belief in his ability. You know, I don't know exactly how far he can go. I think there's still so many questions to answer. Beating Teemu Pakkala is certainly no small feat, but it doesn't really tell you a whole lot about someone's upside. But I've got my eye on this kid. I was very impressed by just the ease with which he handled the moment, how instinctive that right over the top was, how effortless and powerful it was as well. He is a force to be reckoned with, it looks like. So keep your eye on Mark Diakisi. Brad Scott defeating Scott Askham, split decision. 128-29, then 229-28. And then Lena Landsberg defeating Lucy Putilova, 29-28 across the board. You can argue with that scorecard a little bit. Putilova was just better about putting combinations together, but they kept overextending on their reaches and then clinching. And there it was fairly even-ish, one way or the other. Both landing their shots, but another time where guys, or two ladies in this particular case, would get into the fence and couldn't really do a whole lot with each other. They could clinch and clinch attack, but in terms of like any kind of level change or any kind of trips, they couldn't really finish them. So I didn't really so much mind, referee separations in that particular context. Your bonus winners. Fight of the night, not awarded. Performance night. Performance of the night bonuses. Jimi Manuwa, Gunnar Nelson, Marlon Vera, and Mark Diakisi. Very quickly, World Series Fighting 35. This took place at the Turning Stone Resort Casino in Verona, California. Let me say something about this card. I think a lot of people didn't even know this was happening. Now, World Series of Fighting has new owners, and I don't know if that's the reason, but people are not watching this product to a scary degree. Even if you wanted to look at pirated efforts of this card, there were live streams out there that I saw. And by the way, I have DirecTV, my cable bill's out of control, as a matter of fact, but I'm always curious to see if something is heavily pirated, then there's big demand in it. Right, so you can imagine Mayweather McGregor is going to have massive pirating, right? If it ever happens, this had very little. Not just live streams, but after the fact, go and look around at pirated sites. There's almost they don't even bother with it. That's a bad sign, man. It's a really, really, really bad sign. If people who steal content and use it and sell ads against it, like literal thieves, don't even want your content, or don't even know it's there, that's very bad. It's very, very bad. That's where we're at. So I'm not going to waste a whole lot of time on this one. Look away, Ivanov defeating Sean Jordan. Caught him with a right hook. A left hook, I can't remember. Either case. As he over-pursued and then just finished him off from there. Short main event on that one. 143 in the first round. How about this one? Talked about him on the live chat last week. Andre Harrison defeating Lance Palmer. Unanimous decision. Dropped him in the first, second, and fifth. Now, Lance Palmer apparently broke his hand in that first round. And you will recall, he broke his hand at the World Series of Fighting 32. Apparently, he not only broke the same hand, he broke it in the same place. How much did that affect his performance? Obviously, you can decide, but not a good look. But Andre Harrison, you know, looking very strong. And he's your new champ. Let's see. Bekbulat Magomedov defeating Donovan Freelo. Unanimous decision. Abubakar Nurmagomedov defeating Matt Sakor. Hakeem Dawadu versus David Steven Seiler via unanimous decision. By the way, Andre Harrison, just sort of for clarification's sake, since I know you guys don't know who he is a featherweight. Okay, with that out of the way, let's just take a quick look at that awesome left hook from Jimi Manuwa that he used to dispatch with Corey Anderson.
Let's take a look at this footage, slides, in greater detail from UFC Fight Night 107. Of course, the main event, Jimi Manuwa versus Corey Anderson. Short fight, not a whole lot to get to. Obviously, some things you could point out. Jimi Manuwa stuffing the takedowns of Anderson with ease. A couple of those takedowns were just half-hearted reaches. Looked like they were, you know, semi-knee taps that weren't all that serious, and Manuwa moved out of the way. But there was a couple of attempts that were all great, and Manuwa got out of those. Not interested in those exactly for this purpose. You know, it wasn't a huge fight night event, so we're not going to spend a lot of time doing it. Here's what I am interested in. How about that left hook of Jimi Manuwa? And why is that important? You saw it play a big role in the OSP fight, and it played a big role in this fight. He digs it to the body early of Corey Anderson. Now, Corey Anderson is going side to side. He's fainting. He's faking. He's sort of throwing shots. But I want you to look at this picture in particular and even the next one. A couple things you got to remember about what Jimi Manuwa is doing. Number one, he's not really biting on the fakes and feints of Anderson. Anderson might be the one moving a lot. Anderson's the one going side to side, in and out, hands up, hands down, feigning for wrestling shots. It's a little Frankie Edgar-esque. But Jimi Manuwa is laser-focused, using a real nice economy of motion, not really biting on things, just sort of keeping real good sense about him, and using excellent vision, really great anticipatory skills, the whole bit. He sees what Anderson is doing the whole time. He doesn't, I mean, a couple times he bites on some fakes, but not really. And whenever Anderson really tried anything, Manuwa saw it coming a mile away. So here's one of the early ones where the left hook comes into play. Pardon me. Here he is throwing a cross after stepping in, but you can see it's nowhere close, right? Off a few inches, Manuwa reading it all the way, moves away, and Anderson's going to kind of fade right and then fade left, right? Here he is. Now he's sort of open stance for a second. Now this is all just in motion. This is not, he's not standing square with him, but, you know, I'm catching it in real time, or I'm catching it with these slides anyway. And so you see him step out, and you're going to see Manuwa, look at Manuwa looking down the whole time, right? He's going to fade right, and then he's going to fade left, and he's going to fade right. And you see Manuwa is now going to step in. Why? A couple things that was going to happen here. He steps in as Anderson steps back. So Anderson's going side to side, and he's going back and forth, as I mentioned before. In this particular case, he backs up, Manuwa follows, and then Manuwa steps in, and Anderson kind of comes forward at the same time. And you see he's going to leaning off this. It looks like what's going to happen is that the way the body motion works from Anderson is that a jab is going to come, a left is going to come in this particular context. So you see Manuwa is real good about leaning off to the side and then digging that body shot, which scores here hard. Now Anderson kind of blocks it and does the right thing here a little bit, tries to throw a left over the top, which I think partially lands. But just sort of my point here, he's following the motion of Anderson. Let's just watch this a little bit. He's following the motion of Anderson, and as Anderson closes the distance, thinking that Manuwa is going to keep following him, he actually stays in position and then attacks, leans off the side to escape the jab, and then cracks him to the ribs there nice and hard. All right, let's keep going here. This is towards the beginning of the end. There are other moments in the course of this round where he's leaning off to the side. This is all sort of setup context. Really, I want to go through the finish because that's where most of the action happens that I was really interested in. But I just want to talk about, I remember I mentioned before how Manuwa was not really biting on the fakes and feints and just has sick vision right down the field, so to speak. He looks like a quarterback, an elite quarterback doing this. So here comes Anderson level changing, right? Fainting, faking, right? Going side to side, stepping in, and he's going to level change. And as soon as he does, he's greeted with a quick, lightning, fast, accurate, hard jab from Jimi Manuwa. Look at that. Greets him. Boom. Like it was nothing. And he actually almost falls to a knee here and kind of stumbles a little bit. And Manuwa just backs up. Hand here, ready to go. Hand up here, blocking just in case anything happened as he exited range. That didn't get a whole lot of play. And it should have. So here we are. Now we're getting to the beginning of the end. Anderson briefly fades right and then decides to go left, which we all know. But this is why everything is so important. Again, there were a couple times where Manuwa would fake to the left and not throw. You saw that heavy body shot from the left that we saw earlier in the round, and you see him with this brilliant vision that he's got. All these things add up to this moment, because now Anderson wants to get away from the power hand. Okay, great. In retrospect, he probably should have clinched. Now, it's easier said than done. This is, you know, hindsight being 2020, but you get the idea. But here's what Manuwa was going to do. Manuwa was going to look like he's leaning and loading his left, and he's going to drop it, right? Thinking maybe the right's going to come, or, you know, there's some kind of fake behind that, or whatever the case. And instead, what he does is something really interesting. He drops it to get a reaction from Anderson, to get Anderson to stick his hand out, thinking he's loading up and almost telegraphing from that left side. Look at him dropping it here, right? Anderson sees that left dropping and says, I'm going to put a hand out to stop that before it ever gets started. You know, just kind of parry it, wrist, maybe you get wrist control, something to just sort of stop this process before it gets started. But what's interesting is this left hook is not starting nice and tight like a chambered left hook. Think about where the left hook is. Look, it's literally down by his waist. Why? Because he's going to come here at the bottom of the loop to get this reaction, and then he's going to switch and go right up top. Watch. Anderson sticks his hand up, but now he's going to come around the top. And that drops him. Watch this again. Here we go. Here's Anderson fading. Watch Manuwa. He's going to drop his hand. Looks like he's going to load up to that side. Anderson wants to put a hand out to stop that, but it's not. It's starting at the bottom and then looping out over the top, almost like an overhand left, but where you're starting from your hip. Then he catches him. This creates the opening. Look at this, wide open. That is the finish. This is everything. In his other left hook, let's go back to the beginning. There's not too many of these slides, I don't hope. Look at this. Look how he leans off to that side and stays down there, right? This is what Anderson thought he was going to get. Lean off, starts at the bottom, and then just stays digging to the bottom. And he wanted to kind of meet it with his hand. Instead, what he got was this. Watch this in real time. Sort of. I mean, with the slides anyway. Boom. Look at that. One more time. Boom. Boom. See that? See how it loops? That's brilliant. Boom. Starts low, gets a reaction, which creates an opening, and then comes out over the top. Jimi Manuwa has a very nasty left hook. Great vision the whole time. A real economy of motion. Improved takedown defense. This is the best version of Jimi Manuwa we've ever seen. And I know everyone says that after every great win a guy has. But you can really tell. The things he does well, he's applying more consistently. He's catching guys back-to-back in similar ways with the same kind of weapon, and some of the liabilities he had just aren't the same anymore. I'm sure his takedown defense is not the best part of his game, but it's good enough now to keep him in the fight where the striking is the central component of his fights, and you're seeing the consequences. Brilliant adjustment, brilliant use, and just absolute deft hand, quite literally, there by Jimi Manuwa.
And last but not least, we take a look at what's coming up in the week ahead. Not a very busy week. No World Series of Fighting. The next UFC event, I believe, is not until UFC 210, which is not going to be, not even this weekend, but the one after. So that's going to be a little while. But there is going to be a Bellator event this weekend. Bellator 175 Rampage versus King Mo 2. This will take place at the Allstate Arena in Rosemont, Illinois, which is not Chicago. It is Rosemont. In the main event, Quentin Jackson, at heavyweight, by the way, faces Muhammad Lawal. I was there for the first one, and I thought Lawal won that fight, but that was the night that the term in MMA wasn't born exactly, but introduced into the MMA lexicon of Dick Ryder. So keep that as it keep that close to your hearts, boys. Sergey Kharitonov returns after that devastating last loss he had versus Chase Gormley. Marcus Galvan faces Emmanuel Sanchez. Steve Cazola faces Jake Roberts. And Noad Lahat versus Lloyd Carter. No one that I'm really aware of on the prelim cards that is worth paying attention to. So not the greatest card in the world for that. But there you go. If you have any questions or comments, please, by all means, email me at luke.thomas@espnation.com. If you look below, these are my Instagram and my Facebook accounts, same name. You can find me on either of those. Please add me if you could. That'd be so great. And yeah, thank you guys so much for watching. Not a big one today, but we'll have some more content for you as the weeks go on. Thank you guys so much for watching. Subscribe to this channel. Thumbs up. Share it around. Until next time. Enjoy the fights.